Welcome, church family and friends, to our worship service this Sunday morning on the Lord's Day. Happy Independence Day. I hope you all are having a great time. You've had a great time with your family. Just some announcements as we get started here for this morning sermon. For your convenience, we are posting our messages not only on Facebook, but also as well on YouTube for those who are struggling with reception. You can access YouTube from a link on our website and on our Facebook page. As always, I also like to mention that you can always find me on Facebook. I always share the sermon, so you can always find it on my wall as well. But again, the website has the YouTube version, so you have access to both. As you view today, please post a comment. Again, you want to post a comment that has the number of people viewing with you. So if you are viewing it with a couple kids and your wife, that would be four. And you just on the comment icon area, you would just put four in that area on Facebook. Please do that. For you doing that, thank you so much. It's helping us to keep track of just the viewings and people that are still continually following us. And it's also kind of cool to see all you that maybe used to go here and moved away. It's always exciting to see you on Facebook, as well as some of you farther away. And so with that being said, we want to kind of maintain a habit of everybody watching around 10:30 a.m. You know, we want to stay as if we're really still at church. So if you are still uncomfortable coming in, we have service at 10:30 here, physically, where we can come in. But we also ask that at 10:30, you with your families continue to watch it at that same time frame. That way you guys can have that habit, so when you come back to gathering, it's just back to the normal there. As far as tithes and offerings, again, we just want to announce that for you that there'll be tithing option available in the main service here if you're physically here. But for you that are at a distance, you can go through the website, do your giving that way, or you can send it by mail or just even drop it off in the office sometime throughout the week at your convenience. As we talk about just this morning, we want to maintain social distancing, and ushers will be present to direct you to appropriate seating for our family or for your family in compliance with state mandates. Nursery and Children's Church will be taking place without social distancing, with strict adherence for children to remain with their parents if they have either fevers or runny noses. If parents are uncomfortable with this arrangement, we ask that their children remain with them in the worship service. We will be adding Wednesday and evening prayer meetings shortly in addition to our Sunday morning service. At this moment, that's it for announcements. We're going to turn in our Bibles now to Matthew chapter 15, and we're going to be going from verses 29 through 39, and the message is entitled, Compassion, My Motivation for Ministry. And don't forget to share this message on Facebook. In fact, right now, if you're watching on Facebook, please hit the share icon. It takes you just a second, if that. And then when you hit it, it will be able to broadcast this message to all of your Facebook friends. And I just want to remind you, that's something we want to do so we can plant the seed of the gospel into the lives of so many viewers. And so please, please, that's a favor we ask of you to do to help us in our advancement of the good news, which is the gospel. Let's now pray as we open up the service. Lord, I just want to thank you for this time we get to have. Lord, it's exciting that we get to physically be meeting. It's exciting that we can be meeting online. Thank you for the resources available. Not every church has these resources, this equipment. Lord, you've brought it all to us. We definitely were not prepared for this. And I don't think many people were, but Lord, you were. You knew what was going to happen. And so, Lord, you have provided generously to help us do this. And Lord, we just pray for guidance and wisdom. We know we are in a state where there is confusion with so many people. We know we're in a place that can promote fear, and yet, Lord, we ask that you continually reaffirm us that there is no need for fear. Lord, we know that you're in control of this crisis, and there's peace found in that, I truly believe. And so, Lord, please give us that peace. Give us wisdom and discernment as we have unpredictable state mandates every week. And so, Lord, we want to make the right decisions. We know they're not easy, and that's why we need your wisdom. Thank you. And may this sermon this morning reach into the hearts of all viewers, where you can speak to them and work on their hearts as we know it works on ours. Thank you again. May we honor you in the reading of your word and the presenting of your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
So many of you have been following along in our study of verse by verse through the Gospel of Matthew. In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the four Gospels, you're bombarded with a dialogue that Jesus is continually having that involves some pupils called disciples. Lots of discussion today throughout church circles as to what in the world is meant by the word discipleship. We've spent some time in previous weeks to discuss it, to define it. But if the book of Matthew will conclude with a command to make disciples, you can mark it down that Jesus not only instructed us what discipleship is, but what to expect from a disciple and what it is that ought to motivate a disciple to the very end. And so, just by way of a brief review, let's begin in our study of God's Word this morning in Matthew 15 by just, again, reaffirming what a disciple is all about. That definition you'll find on the screen for you. It means a learner or a pupil in a teacher-student relationship. A disciple is one who is learning and promptly obeying as a byproduct of his believing. The passage in Matthew 28, 19 and 20 makes it clear that discipleship begins with believing by faith, followed by baptism as evidence of salvation, and then a continuous and passionate appetite to be taught to obey as fruit of salvation. As we have looked together, we have discovered that disciples, pupils, have been following along with Jesus, but not necessarily disciples from a biblical perspective, because for the first 2 years, we discovered they were following Jesus all for the wrong reasons. They wanted to be in on the ground floor of Jesus establishing his kingdom. And so they left fishing and all kinds of other things so they could be involved in something that would make them very powerful, wealthy individuals as part of Christ's so-called cabinet on earth. As you think about that, the term was used very loosely with these 12. And Jesus begins teaching them that he's talking about a kingdom that isn't so much a physical kingdom right now, there will be one later, but he's talking about a kingdom where Christ reigns in our hearts. And we saw that when that really happens, then it reshuffles all the priorities of life. And we looked at a priority is to arrange something in order of importance, determining what should be placed first ahead of all other tasks. A disciple doesn't balance his walk with Christ. He prioritizes it, making his conformity to Christ, which means holiness, his ultimate purpose for living. So, what should we expect out of a disciple? As we have journeyed together in our study of Matthew, we saw that there were two things that Christ expected out of every would-be disciple. The first one would be faithfulness. Faithfulness means punctually and consistently thorough to his performance of duty, steadfast in keeping commitments as unto the Lord. The second aspect of any long-term discipleship is fruitfulness. Notice both begin with the F so you can remember them. Faithfulness and fruitfulness. Fruitfulness is treasuring and pursuing the eternal over the temporal. In other words, you're always putting what is going to matter for all of eternity above everything from families to work and everything else that is temporal down here. Now, as we look at Christ's curriculum that he is carefully not only instructing, but just as importantly, modeling to these 12 individuals, notice with me that it being the Lord Jesus, Creator God, as the rabbi here, it still is taking his disciples over 2 years to really understand what it means to have Christ on the throne of your heart. What is saving faith? And so Jesus, with a litany of parables, explains to them about what saving faith is all about. It's not different for one culture to another. It's not redefined by various different religions. We saw that absolute truth, which is whatever God's word says, is truth is defined by God for everyone, no matter where they live, in every situation, for all of time. It's objective and it's absolute. God uses absolute truth to protect, provide, and perfect me. And so absolute truth is what we must have as our final cornerstone as to whether or not we have placed our faith and trust in Jesus Christ and can claim all the verses in the Bible about knowing that we know that we know that as we breathe our last breath, we will be in the presence of the Lord. Now, with all the instruction and over 2 years, the disciples still not getting it. Remember, Jesus took them on a couple of object lessons, some field trips. And the first one was feeding 5,000 men. We saw that it could have included a group of 30 to 40,000 because it was just the men counted here. The women and children were all in addition to that. And as you see Jesus doing that, we saw that the disciples' faith were resting in themselves, how much money they had, how much food they had in order to pay the crowd, and they couldn't do it. Christ had just talked about saving faith and putting your trust in Jesus Christ, and none of the disciples turned to Christ to be able to deliver for the crowd. So there was the feeding of the multitude for a Jewish audience. Still not getting it, Jesus sent them out, remember, on a voyage across the Sea of Galilee. A storm breaks out. They're all ready to drown in the midst of the storm. Jesus approaches them. And finally, the disciples, 11 of the 12 disciples, conclude, Jesus is the Messiah. And he's not just talking about a physical kingdom. He needs to be reigning in my heart. I need to surrender my life to him. So what was it that if Jesus really now has communicated what saving faith is all about, what does he move to next? And we saw last week he moved into culture, didn't he? Traditions. In other words, it's so easy for us to think that we're going to go to heaven because of the traditions of the particular denomination or churches that we've been raised in. We follow those and don't know the scriptures, and our confidence is resting what our parents or what our church says and rather than what God's word says. So Christ breaks out and explains it's got to be the bottom line. It's got to be scripture. And then secondly, it doesn't make any difference what a religious culture has to say. Once again, it matters what Christ has to say. And so we're watching Christ strip away the prejudice of these disciples as it related to their relationship to Gentiles that were absolutely scorned by their Jewish culture. Now, Jesus is going to address something that's been in the process, but hasn't necessarily stood out to us, and certainly had not stood out yet to the disciples. It is what Jesus is hammering home here when he only has 7 months left before he lays down his life at the cross. What is it that Jesus wants to communicate as 7 months is left? You see, Jesus is looking for these pupils not only to know the truth, not only to have absolute clarity in sharing the gospel and how somebody gets to heaven. And he wants them to see that it goes across all cultural divides. It's for every human being on the face of the earth, no matter what color of skin. As we see that, what is going to keep these disciples going if Jesus is going to leave in 7 months? What happens if they just quit and go back? We see this happening all the time. We see people retiring and walking away from ministry, thinking it's somebody else's job to do now. What caused Jesus to finish his work on earth well? John chapter 13, verse 1 says, he loved these disciples to the very end. In other words, right up to the cross, there was never a time when they showed all kinds of lack of faith, frustrated with the comments, with their actions and everything. At no time, right up to the death of Christ, did Jesus ever give up or quit on them. What is this incredible ingredient that motivates Jesus to the very end? It's the same thing that needed to motivate the 12, because you see the 11 disciples who are now believers, 10 of them will be martyrs. And we know the end of all 11 of these disciples, how they finished the race well, right up to their death. And as we look at that, what gave them the staying power? What motivated them in the wake of calamity, in the wake of hostility? What motivated them to get up and be excited every day that they awakened from their sleep through the night to be passionate about today? Well, let's look at this word, compassion, shall we? What does it mean? To emotionally suffer together or enter into the suffering of others. The word is a compound word. In other words, it's two words put together. With con, the word means with, passion. Real simple. What is compassion? It's with passion. The Greek word in the New Testament is a verb that means to be moved in the seat of your emotions into passionate action. It is used continually throughout Scripture for Christ, seeing people as sheep who were helpless, lost, and headed to eternity apart from the salvation that he alone could provide. Faithfulness as a disciple is impossible to be maintained without it. Notice all the illustrations all the way through the Old Testament and the New Testament that Christ has a never-ending, great is his compassion toward each and every one of us. In fact, all the way through Scripture, he even illustrates this compassion. And to help us understand it and get this word into our mind, he talks about how a dad is driven with compassion toward his children. You see, when a dad sees his child mistreated, when he sees his child going through difficult times, something comes over him in the seat of his emotions, and he's moved to directly get involved in his little boy or his little girl's life. The Lord uses this word compassion and illustrates it with a mom. When a mom has given birth to a little baby, and the little baby cries out when the baby is hungry, something comes over the mother that compels her to go into this little infant and feed this little infant. As you see what is happening, it drives her into passionate action. When you think about it in a family circle, it is interesting today that when we look at ministry, oftentimes we conclude that ministry is done because we're supposed to, because it is a duty. Can I just say this? If you're looking at your parenting as a duty, you will fail miserably. If you look at ministry as a duty, not only will you fail miserably, but it will never be sustained. And Jesus wants the disciples' ministry to be sustained, and he culminates and helps them understand what will motivate them right up to their death date is this word, compassion. Lots of times when ministries are presented in a church, we express the need. Sometimes individuals hear that need and it moves them. Take, for instance, a nursery ministry. The thought that because a little child is being loved in the nursery, mom and dad get to be in here, that moves some individuals to say, you know what? I wish we would have had instruction when we were raising kids. Man, if I can watch their children so they'll be not distracted and be able to be taught, man, I'm excited to do that. I have a passion to see mommies and daddies fall in love with the Word of God. So let me get involved there. Can you see where it would happen with children's ministries? You see little children coming to an Olympian program, some other child's program. And so often we think it's games and classroom and snacks and various different things. And if we get it done, well, we covered it another night. That's sure good when we get a week off, though. We're glad for summer breaks, and we're glad when we don't have to do it. And all the time that we're doing it, lots of times we're looking over our shoulders and asking ourselves, why doesn't so-and-so get involved? Why is it always me that is doing it? At that particular point, we need to stop everything. Compassion isn't driving ministry. Duty is. And ministry will be very short-lived. You'll quit. You'll give up. You'll pass the baton to somebody else and become a spectator. We try to motivate youth staff to get excited about teenagers. And some will respond, yeah, that must be really important. I'll get involved with teens. But we come late and we get out as fast as we can and check our little box that we attended and were involved there. When compassion enters into the life of a youth worker, they are eager to be a part of teenagers' lives. They come early, they stay late, they get involved and get to know the kids. And you know what else? They get to know the homes they come from. They want to get involved in the lives, not just on Wednesday or Sunday morning. They want to get involved in their life. Why? Because they have a passion. From the innermost part of their being to get involved in bringing somebody to Christ or helping them grow in Christ. It's not somebody else's job. It's not for a youth pastor to motivate or anything else. It's what happens when compassion is driving me. You know, it's not just youth workers. It's not just children's workers, nursery workers. It's not just Sunday school teachers. The same is true for pastors. I know Pastor Dan and myself. And it's easy for us to get into a rut where we're doing things for the sake of doing it. And we're looking down the road, how much longer am I going to do this? Well, you see, what we're doing as pastors isn't our duty. It isn't we're doing it because nobody else would do it. God wants us to be pastors who passionately love bringing people to Christ and love them enough to help them grow up in Christ. If nobody else does it, God wants to move us to do it. It's hard for me even to get my arms around, end quote, retiring, walking away, saying it's somebody else's job. It becomes someone else's job when Jesus takes me home, or when I physically can no longer do what he's called me to do. Compassion gives me the staying power. Demas in the New Testament started out as a great co-worker of Paul, but he walked away from Paul, getting himself wrapped up in this present world, 2 Timothy 4 reminds us. It's an easy trap for any of us, whether we're working with infants, children, adults, pastors. It's easy for us to get wrapped up into these other things. Now let's look. If compassion is really going to drive us so that we have staying power to the very end until God takes us home, how in the world does it happen? Well, once again, the Lord's not going to tell us to do something without modeling it and showing us, giving us the recipe. Look with me at our text as we look, first of all, in chapter 15 at verse 29. And Jesus departed from there and came near unto the Sea of Galilee and went up into a mountain and sat down there. What is going on? Now, if we continue to read the text, we see that Jesus is about to do an incredible miracle that is similar to a miracle he's already done. It is one of the biggest miracles in the Gospels. It is interesting to see that Jesus goes up in the mountains to be alone. It is exactly what Jesus did prior to feeding the 5,000 Jews, remember, which was a group of anywhere from 30 to 40,000, counting wives and children. What did Jesus do that sustained him for that ministry to do that great thing? Well, if you go back and read in Mark chapter 6, you'll find out that Jesus, first of all, before that, was alone. In fact, before that event took place, Jesus told the disciples to get alone. And we ask ourselves, why the emphasis of getting alone? Remember, the topic is compassion, and let's see where this takes us. You see, when you talk about compassion, compassion is when your heart is moved for someone else. As you think about it, it's interesting, we don't have too much difficulty if we are a sports fan for our sports teams, for us to be moved with the compassion, to be caught up in the emotion, wanting our team to win, and sickened in the fact that they didn't. And we look at how our emotions from our innermost being well up. How do we initiate that towards something that really matters for eternity? Well, my friend, the first thing you have to do is get alone. Why would we get along? Why does God ask for a day of rest? People say, well, Tim, I don't need a day of rest. We do all kinds of family things. We go all kinds. We go to terms. We get all kinds of things. And I just get up and go to work the rest of the week. I'm able to go strong. You know what you're not able to do? You're not able to grasp why God says you need rest. You see, when I get physical rest, I am ministering to my needs. When I get my physical needs met with rest on a regular basis, and I have time with the Lord Jesus in my time of rest, I get spiritually refreshed because I know that when the rest is over, my life isn't going to be about me. My life is going to be about pouring my life into others, getting excited about what God's doing in somebody else's life or what God wants to do in somebody else's life. So I have to have my needs met and satisfied, and therefore rest and spiritual rest is absolutely vital, no matter what it is, no matter what stage of life you are in, no matter how you think you are the ever-ready bunny that keeps going and going and going. God says that if you ever are going to experience the kind of compassion that sustains you and enables you and excites you about whatever it is God's calling you to do, you got to have rest. In the time of rest, you then are refreshed to think not about yourself anymore, but to refocus, why does God have me down here? And of course, we understand that We are down here for the same reason Jesus came down here, to seek and to save that which was lost, to walk in his steps, as Peter suggests, so that we're doing what he's doing. And Jesus' life was all about others. He never got tired of pouring his life into others because he was continually getting alone to be refreshed spiritually and physically. So the very first step in causing compassion to be a major motivation for my ministry is to be alone and regularly have times of refreshment physically and spiritually. God mapped it out for us to take a day of this each and every week. Now next, notice with me compassion that powerfully strips away all apathy. We have an unusual church here at Grace. A good number of all who attend here are involved in ministry. But in far too many churches, there are just a handful of people involved, and the rest are sitting in the stands as spectators. How do we get people motivated out of their apathetic thought of ministry and their walk with God? Notice that when you have been time to be alone with God, your head is up. You're now starting to look at others. Remember, Jesus told the disciples, keep your head up. The fields are white unto harvest. And what he's saying here is that when your head is up, you see things no one else sees. In other words, when you see a little child come to a child's program, you look at this life, your head is up and you see, you're not just running a program, you're not just running a game, you're not just running a lesson, you're looking into the lives, into the eyes of these children, and you're starting to see needs that came with this child, that are going to be with this child as they go home, and your heart is moved to the place, how do I get involved in this little child's life? How do I get involved in this teenager's life? Your head is up. Your focus is off yourself, off your family, onto others. And now you're starting to see things because your head is up. What did Jesus see? He saw something that the disciples didn't see. He saw a large crowd, 15,000, that had followed Jesus for 3 days and had no food. The disciples, the only thing they could have been thinking about is, you know what, Jesus, you better wrap this thing up. We don't have much food. With no real thought about what the need was of the multitude. And besides, the Jews were looking at it, the disciples being Jews, they're Gentiles. Not our job, not our responsibility. And of course, that's not true either, is it? And so, 3 days without food not only told them about the physical needs, but something else the disciples didn't see was that these Gentiles needed the Lord. They had spiritual needs. They had physical needs. People were crippled. People were going through all kinds of different things. They were crippled. They were spiritually blinded. They were without food. Join me as I read those verses from verse 32 through 36. Then Jesus called his disciples unto him and said, I have compassion on the multitude, because they continue with me now 3 days and have nothing to eat. And I will not send them away fasting, lest they faint in the way. And his disciples said unto him, from where should we have so much bread in the wilderness so as to feed this great multitude? And Jesus said unto them, how many loaves have you? And they said, seven and a few little fishes. And he commanded the multitude to sit down on the ground. And he took the seven loaves and the fishes and gave thanks and broke them and gave it to his disciples and the disciples to the multitude. It almost seems like this miracle is happening all over again. There have been lots of different critics that have said This is just errors in Scripture. It was just the same event. My friend, as Jesus goes out to feed this great multitude, remember just several weeks ago, we saw how he fed this great multitude of Jews. Now he's feeding a great multitude of Gentiles. Let's look at the difference here. And for those who are critical of the text, oftentimes it's just because they have done very poor evaluation of both texts. Notice that with the 5,000 men, it was Jews. With the 4,000, it was Gentiles. The location with the Jews was near Bethsaida. The location of the Gentiles was Decapolis. In the first one, there were 5 loaves and 2 fishes. In this one, there were 7 loaves and a few fish. As we think about the remains that are left after everybody is fed, remember there are 12 baskets left of the 5,000 men being fed. Of this, there are 7 hampers of food left. The 5,000 men are fed in the spring. The Gentiles are fed in the summer. The crowd was with Jesus when the 5,000 men were fed one day. The crowd of Gentiles that were with Jesus were with him 3 days. Do you see how God goes out of his way to separate the things because they're 2 separate events? It isn't a mistake of the text, isn't misprints or anything else. They are completely different events that God is reestablishing, and he's trying to help us understand what compassion is all about. He's seeing something the disciples could not see. Their hearts were not moved with compassion like Christ. Now, as we see what takes place here in verses 31 and 36, verse 31 said that these Gentiles started glorifying God, their spiritual needs. And then in verse 36, it says, all were fed. Every one of them, 4,000 men, their wives, and their children, everybody, including the disciples, were fed. Now let's look at that third point, compassion, that leaves behind more than the basics. Do you know what is true about the Lord's compassion for us? He not only sees our needs, but he gives me more than my needs. He always goes more than what I ever dreamed could possibly be. For those disciples, those of little faith, let's look at the last few verses here. And they did all eat and were filled, and they took up of the broken pieces that were left 7 baskets full. And they that did eat were 4,000 men besides women and children. And he sent away the multitude and got into a boat, and they came to the borders of Magadan. As we look at what is taking place here, can you imagine the disciples just reeling over this? For the disciples who Jesus earlier has identified as having very little faith, God is reinforcing that the gospel message isn't just for the Jews. It's for everyone. Everybody needs to hear the good word. Everybody needs to know how they can be right with God and what Jesus has done for each and everyone. It is not unique to one country, one race, or anything else. And so God is enforcing that, pounding it away in their minds, and there will be more lessons along the road that Jesus is going to have to do with these disciples, these pupils of his. But he's etching it in his mind. And in fact, as we think about them, it is interesting, a little word, as we think about the 12 baskets left over from feeding the 5,000 earlier, a couple chapters ago, there were 12 baskets. A basket was something where you could put a day's worth of food in and carry it around with you. Interesting, the word here for basketfuls here is a different Greek word. It means a hamper. It is the same word used in Acts that, remember that where Paul was lowered down over the walls to escape a city, and where was he put? In a hamper. This is a large, large hamper, wicker basket that Paul is that a whole person can get into. That's the word that's used here. We're not talking about something that could carry your meals for a day. We're talking about a hamper. A whole person could get in there. What God is emphasizing with your little faith, I want you to know that God is always going to do more than anything that you can imagine if you'll put your trust in Him. And then secondly, for the lost audience, well, you see, they got more than a lunch, didn't they? Physical needs were met. People were healed. They were fed. Their physical needs met. But spiritually, they heard the gospel and they glorified the one true God. Wow. All they were expecting was for somebody to heal their sick. But on top of that, they got fed. And then they got spiritually fed. They got to understand what it meant to be right with the holy God. They didn't deserve it, but no one does. And they were thrilled to death as they went home, completely filled, both physically and spiritually. So let's look at some applications together. First, since compassion is developed behavior, it is vital curriculum in effective parenting. Do you know that God has put a little measure of compassion in us all? But you either can grow callous to it, or you can nurture it for it to grow and grow and grow. And what God wants us to do as mommies and daddies is to nurture compassion in the lives of our little ones. How in the world does this happen? Well, first of all, just like Jesus, you model it. You demonstrate it to them. Your children will ask you, but Daddy, why do you have to be involved in the kids' ministry today or tonight? Why do you have to be involved with teenagers? Why do you need to go on this activity? Don't you see, kids, it's not a duty. Don't you understand that it's not something I have to do because I agreed to do it? Kids, I want you to understand, I am thrilled to do this. I'm excited to do this because those kids that I will be with have all kinds of needs. My head's going to be up and I can't wait to draw alongside, find out whether they need Jesus Christ as their Savior, what kind of problems are going in the home. I can't wait to find that out. I can't be late and I won't be the first to leave. Why? Because I'm not checking in the clock. This isn't duty. This is a ministry driven by compassion. You got to model it. You got to teach it. You got to show them what it means that no matter where you take your children, heads are up and you're constantly looking and envisioning the people at a store, at a gas station. As you take your child with you, no matter where you go, you are talking with them, as Deuteronomy reminds us, and explaining what you are seeing in regard to the lives that you are engaged with, the people that pass you, the how you drive, and everything else. All the individuals in the course of the week, our neighbors, who we work with, kids. Let's look at our neighborhood. Do you know where so-and-so stands with the Lord? What are their needs? Well, we don't know. How will we as a family get to know them? What will we do to bridge that gap? You see how compassion causes you to look at your neighborhood, your place of employment, and every acquaintance in your life with a whole different perspective. Think about what that does with ministry. Lots of times children grow up and resent their parents' involvement in ministry. And it's because children never were taught why we do ministry. It's not out of duty. It needs to be driven by compassion, or we will resent those individuals that are not involved. We pour our life and take our children with us and teach them, and even maybe taking them on little ministry trips whereby we go maybe to a mall and you take them with you and you train them how to look up and look at all the people that are milling around, let's say in a mall, and ask them, do you think they know Jesus? What can you see about this person's life where maybe we could be a help? You help the children start looking up and seeing not what I ought to get at the mall, but the people that are there and the need that they have that only the Lord Jesus can provide. Secondly, ministry that is not driven by compassion will never be effectively sustained. As you think about ministry, Paul says, the love for Jesus Christ constrains me. From my innermost being, I can't help do what I do by keeping my head up and challenging people to come to Christ and to grow in Christ. I can't help but be involved in other people's lives. My friend, if compassion is not driving your ministry, you're going to eventually be apathetic toward ministry. It's all what somebody else ought to be doing, not what you need to be doing. You'll be irritated because those around you aren't as involved as you are. You resent them. They show up late. They aren't doing what you're doing. You see, at that point, God says, time out. You need a day of refreshment to get your focus off yourself. You need to get along with the Lord, get your physical and spiritual needs met, because normal is your head up, pouring your life into other people. And when I get to be apathetic, when I get irritated with others, when I feel resentment toward others, that means I'm looking at ministry as a duty, not the privilege that God has called it to be. As we think about this coronavirus, God literally has called time out into all kinds of ministries. I'm hoping individuals that are involved in nursery, children's church, VBS, Olympians, all of our kids' ministries, all that you are involved in, junior high ministries, senior high ministries, that you are taking this time out and asking yourself, why are you doing what you're doing? If you're looking at this coronavirus and saying, boy, it sure is nice not to have Sunday night. Boy, it sure is nice not to have youth group. It gives me so much more time to do this, this, or that. My friend, you don't understand what compassion is all about. If we really have the Lord's kind of compassion, it grieves our innermost soul that we didn't have VBS. It grieves our innermost soul that we're not having youth group, that we're not having these outreach called camp and everything else. It grieves me because teenagers need Jesus Christ. Is that what you're picking up from the virus? Maybe God has just called time out across the board in ministries to get us to pause and ask ourselves, why are we doing what we're doing? Or why are we not involved? Maybe you're saying, I used to do, but I don't do it anymore. I got, end quote, burned out. Burnout is always because ministry was done out of duty, never out of compassion. You cannot get burned out if compassion is driving you. You'll never walk away of it if compassion is driving you. Why? Because Jesus, as the model of compassion, says it carried on with him toward his disciples in John chapter 13, verse 1, to the very end. If you've been called to work with teens, children, it's going to drive you to the very end. You're not looking for how I can check out. You're looking about what I can do more to get involved in people's lives. It's something that drives pastors. It's something that drives elders. It's something that drives Sunday school teachers. We're not just doing lessons just to preach and teach lessons. We're driven to impart truth because we care about people coming to Christ and people growing up in Christ. Third, the response to the greatest act of compassion the world will ever see is dictated by human choice. You know, here Jesus has fed 5,000 men, including their wives and children on top of it. And what did they do? They were critical. They picked it apart and found fault with it. That's what the Jewish audience did. This Gentile audience, a little bit smaller, what did they do with this great miracle? It says they glorified God. What's the difference between the two groups? You see, each Jew, each Gentile, each and every one of us have to make a personal choice. Jesus has extended to us immense compassion. There is no greater way where anybody has entered into my needs or anybody else's needs like Jesus has when he went to the cross and laid down his life. You know, God's word says that for a good man, some would lay down their life for. But did Jesus do it that way? No, God says when we had nothing to offer him, Christ died for us. God says you won't see compassion like that any place on the planet. Any place in the universe. Jesus embodied compassion and becomes the motivation for why we do things. But we have a choice. You that are involved with ministry have a choice. Are you going to take this pause, get along with God, and say, God, I've been serving you. Whether it's parenting, whether it's my ministry at church, I've been doing this out of duty because I felt like I had to. I can't wait for my kids to get past this section or this section. It's a duty I have to go through. I don't know how much longer I'll work with junior high or these kids. It's a duty that I have to go through. God is pulling back the blinds into our lives, believer, and he's saying, you're serving me for the wrong reason and you cannot sustain it. You're going to get it burned out. May the coronavirus, this break called time out, causing us to take some time alone and say, God, ministry is never going to be the same after today. I'm going to look at whether it's adults, whether it's children, whether it's teens, I'm going to look at their lives from a whole different perspective. I'm tired of just getting excited about a football game or a baseball game or anything else and being so excited or so despondent over an athletic event. I'm tired of me being so overwhelmed with all that and not overwhelmed with what I see. In fact, Lord, to be honest with you, my head is down on myself. And I ask you for forgiveness for that. Lift up my head. Get my mind off myself. And God, no matter what excuse I've ever used, I know I need this rest and refreshment. And that's going to be built into my life this week because I no longer am going to do things because I have to. But because I can't help but do them. The love of Christ constrains me to do it from the innermost being of my soul. Just like those two crowds, though, that heard the good news, the spiritual news of how Jesus wants to be king of our hearts. One group said no. One group picked it apart. Another group humbled them and said, God, that's what I need. I knew I was never going to be good enough. I know it's God plus what I do. It has to be all what Christ did. And so I'm turning away from going my own way and I'm putting my faith and trust in you. Maybe today you're finally putting the pieces together and saying, I really don't think up to this point in my life I've understood what saving faith is all about. But right now, through a choice I'm going to make, I am going to respond to Christ's compassion for me and going to the cross for me. I'm going to respond to Him right now by surrendering my life back to Him. It can be done simply by this little prayer that we often include at the end of our services that would go in a prayer similar like this. Dear Heavenly Father, I was made by You and I was made for You, but I have been living for myself. I'm sorry for this self-rule You call sin. I believe that Jesus Christ, being my Creator God, died, was buried, and rose again to pay the insurmountable debt that my sin has created. And so right now, I am turning from a life of going my own way to, by faith, place my trust in Jesus Christ as God the Son to pay the debt of all my sin and to get me to heaven when I breathe my last breath. Lord Jesus, from today on, I am Yours. Thanks for saving me this very moment. In Jesus' name, amen. If you meant that prayer with all your heart, you just got birthed into God's forever family. You have chosen to receive the compassion that Jesus has demonstrated to you by going to the cross to pay the death penalty that you or I both deserve. Now you're embarking on what does it mean to grow in Christ and have the compassion that Jesus had for my sphere of influence. And this is where we as a church come alongside and say, we want to help you grow. If you made that decision and you're living in our vicinity here in Colville, Washington, give the church office a call, 509-684-5936. You may get an answering service, but if you leave your name and a phone number, we'll promptly get back to you or tag us on Facebook. We want to follow up with you if you made that decision to help you grow in Christ. For some of you, they're a bit older that have been following along with us, maybe even miles and miles away. And you're now toward the last few chapters of your life. You're running well. Compassion has driven your life. God's richest blessings on you. I have a dear friend that lives in Indiana that joins us, listens in. He lives in Goshen, Indiana. John Miller's his name. And you know what? I got a chance to talk with him, and my goodness, what a dear brother in Christ and how he is finishing well. Man, that's exactly how I want to finish my chapter. Compassion makes it all possible. Thanks so much for joining us today.